what he did on the cross. On the cross, he took our sins. On the cross, he defeated death. On the cross, he defeated the sentence. And he brought us back into sonship by faith in him. So tell me why I should fear devil. When the Father is here, holy like a lion, tell me why I should fear devil. Tell me why I should fear death. The Bible says, the key of hell and of death is in the hand of Jesus. Jesus took it from the sinner the day he defeated him. So who decides when to die? It's you. You decide, okay, I won't die. You decide when to die. Don't let anyone or Satan or thoughts tell you, you're going to die. You're going to die. No. The power of death is now in the hand of Jesus. That's why the Bible says, death reigned from Adam to Moses. And that's where he stopped. In a new creation, death stopped reigning. It is life and immortality. Who is reigning? So you choose to die. The reason why some of us die early is because we are too carnal-minded. When you are full of carnal-minded, when you are full of the worldly issues, that's why you die early. Why? Because Satan knew that the moment he brought you to this earth, he brought your mind back to the things of the earth. The moment he brought your mind back to the things of the earth, he's going to defeat you. That's why he brings you thoughts about the earth. But if you can walk in the spirit, if you can focus on Christ, if you can think of what Christ done for you, it will affect everything. It will affect your marriage. It will affect your mind. It will affect your company. It will affect your works. Be spiritual minded. Be spiritual minded. Because you are a spirit being. Jesus said, that which is born of the spirit is spirit. How can you be fearing them? How can you be fearing demons? You know who you are? Even if you are not born again yet, this earth belongs to man, not to demons. Demons only need access to possess your body as an unbeliever. They need attention. They put fear in you. We're gonna kill you. No. Get your mind back to the things of Christ. Jesus Christ came. He died. And the Bible says, through death, he defeated him. He destroyed him. Who has the power of death? And he mentioned his name, devil. So the devil has no destiny. The devil has no destiny. His only destiny that left for him is the lake of fire. You have destiny. Your destiny is the kingdom of the Father. So why will you be fearing the devil? They don't have your life with full fear of death. I'm afraid of death. I'm afraid of Satan. No. Can I tell you something? If Satan will kill you, he has to kill you before salvation. The best way to kill you is to kill you first from not knowing Jesus. But then now that you know Jesus, they tell you, you need to fast. You need to fast. You need to pray. You need to do this, do that, to overcome devil. Satan will defeat you through your religious activities. To walk in victory is to walk in what Jesus has finished for you. Keep in memory what Jesus has done for you. In the book of Revelation 12, verse 11, he said, we overcame him
by the blood of the Lamb and by the words of our testimony. That is how we keep the devil defeated. When he's not through you, you remind him about what Jesus has done. It is not you to destroy Satan. The defeat of Satan is the work of Christ. Have you ever seen? Read the Bible. Throughout Genesis to Revelation. Have you ever seen Israel fasting, praying to defeat Satan? No. You can't defeat Satan by prayer. You can't defeat Satan by fasting. You keep Satan in his defeat mode through the word. That's why the Bible says we overcome him by the blood and then by your testimony. Your testimony is the gospel in your lips. The gospel in your mouth is what you use to defeat Satan every day. Satan is defeated. Satan remains defeated when you know the truth. If you don't know the truth about what Jesus has finished, oh my God, he will keep you slave, keep you as his slave. He will put fear in you. He will make you look miserable. He will make you feel like you are no problem. But when you know who you are in Christ, you reign in life. The Bible said, those who receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life. Reigning in life has nothing to do with the money you have in your bank account. It has nothing to do with how many cash you have in your account. Reigning in life is to live according as God has called you to live. It's to live a life full of joy. It's to live a life full of purpose. It's to live a life full of Christ conscious. That is the meaning of reigning in life. People who have money. People who have money. Some of the people who have money, if you can check, like they are miserable. They don't have happiness. So if money means, if having money means you are reigning in life, why are they not reigning? Why are they not happy? This has to tell you that reigning in life has to do with you walking in the Spirit. To walk in the Spirit is to walk in the gospel. And to walk in the gospel is to walk in what Jesus has accomplished. So Jesus has done this for you. For you to walk in it. For you to be bold. When you are bold, some people tell you like, some people say, become too proud. You are too proud. You are too proud of yourself. Humble yourself. Humble yourself. This word we are not sending to anywhere. We are not going anywhere with this word. So humble yourself. No. Walk in boldness. That is not to say, just go about and blasting people. No. That is not to say. When I'm talking about reigning life, when I'm talking about boldness, I'm talking about walking in the word. The word is what has to make you to walk in boldness. In the truth of what Jesus Christ doesn't make you to walk in goodness. Nothing in this life will make you walk in goodness. So open the Bible. Study it. And understand what Jesus did for you. Until you know the truth, you can never be happy. That's why you are seeking people. You are seeking people attention. Only to be happy. If you really understand what it means to be Son of God, what you mean to be a child of God, you'll be happy for the rest of your life. If only you will know that your sins have been forgiven, that there is nothing between you and God, that God loves you, that God is with you and not against you. You'll be happy. But you have this consciousness that this thing I've done, I think God hates it. You do it again. You still have the process. You are full of guilt and condemnation. How can you go to God with that kind of conscience?
I told you earlier that as long as you are in this flesh, as long as you are in this flesh, you will mess it. Because you refuse to renew your mind. Or because of your own decision. So anytime you mess up, that has nothing to do with what Jesus done for you. What Jesus done for you is eternally. Hebrews 10:10. He says he has sanctified you forever. So there is nothing you can do to stop God from loving you. There is nothing you can do to make God love you more. God loves us equally. The same way God loves you, the same way He loves me. The same way God loves Him, the same way He loves me. Because the love of God is Christ. So if you don't know the love of God, it's because you don't know Christ. So God loves you. Remove this consciousness that God doesn't like me because I do this. No. Whatsoever you do, or however you mess it up, renew the mind. Because in the gospel, it said God loves you. So use the gospel to renew your mind. Because there is nothing you can do to make God stop loving you. Remove that consciousness. God loves you eternally. What is the proof? Jesus Christ.
Yes,
so Jesus came. Jesus came to tell us that God so loves us and that He gave His Son. So the Son of God is a gift for you. It's your gift. So you need to go. You need to go and study about what the Son of God came to do for you. He was given to you. So go find out this person God has given to you. What at all did He come to do in my life? Then when you begin to ask that question, you will understand the value of the cross. The cross is where all your sin, your pain, your defeats, anger, everything was laid upon. God carry all your pains, all your diseases, all your sicknesses has been nailed on the cross. And the Bible says in 1 Peter 2:24, it says He bore your sin in His body. He bore your sin in His body, and by His stripes you are healed. You still can't understand. We go to God. Say, Father, take away the sickness. Take away the sickness. You are missing it. It says, He bore your sins. And by His right, Jesus' right, you were healed. You were healed 2,000 years ago. Your healing is in Jesus. Your healing is not with the Father. The Father has already given you everything you would need in life. So if you are praying to God, God, please save me. I'm a sinner. Save me. You are wrong. That is ignorance prayer. Because the Bible says, God through Christ has saved you from your sin. God through Christ has saved you from your sin. And then He hand over the gospel into the hand of men to preach the gospel to you. So that faith comes by hearing. So when you hear the gospel about what Jesus has done for you, you will receive salvation from the gospel, not from God. Because salvation is not in the hand of God in heaven, it is in the hand of the gospel. Your salvation is in the gospel. Paul said in Romans 10, Paul says, how shall they be saved if there is no preacher? How shall they call upon the Lord if there is no one who is sent to preach? In another word, without a preacher, there is no salvation. So your salvation is in the gospel. So what you have to run have to run after the gospel. Because in Romans chapter 1, verse 16 and 17, it says the gospel is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes. For in the gospel is the righteousness of God with you. So all the power you are seeking, all the miracles you are seeking, everything you are seeking is in the gospel. And what is the gospel? The gospel is what? What Jesus came to do. How he resurrected. And how he set you free from sin. So when you hear the gospel, it impacts faith into you for you to receive salvation. Everything you need, from God is in the gospel. Your forgiveness is in the gospel. Your freedom is in the gospel. Going to God and cry to God, please forgive me, is ignorance. God stopped forgiving 2,000 years ago. He closed the office from forgiveness. The office of forgiveness, he closed it. Why? Because the death of Jesus has brought forgiveness unto all. And everyone has been forgiven by the Father according to the death of Jesus. So you have to be told the good news so that you can believe it and receive it that yes, I am forgiven. That is why the gospel is called testimony. The gospel is not about what God is going to do. The gospel is what God has done through Jesus Christ. So when you run to God, God, please forgive me. It's ignorance. When you run to God, please save me. You will die without salvation. Because your salvation, your forgiveness, your everything is in the gospel. So what you need to do, sit down under the gospel. Keep on hearing. And the Bible says, faith comes by hearing. In another word, confidence of what Jesus has done comes by hearing. You need to hear that your debt has been paid by Jesus Christ. You need to hear that Jesus, by death, God has forgiven you. You need to hear that your salvation is in the gospel. You need to hear that your Holy Ghost is in the gospel. You need to hear that everything you need is right in the gospel. So what you need to do? Sit down and hear the good news. Gospel means good news. If what you are hearing is not a good news, you are not hearing the gospel. Any message you hear from God that puts fear in you is not from the Father. Any message you hear that how you want to do before God can do is not from the Father. That message is against what Christ has done. That message is disqualifying the work of Christ. So if the message is not telling you what God, through His Son, has done, you are sitting under wrong message, under wrong spirit. So John said, test every spirit. And know whether they are of God. Because if the spirit is of God, the first thing the spirit will do is that it will assert the name of Jesus. Because Jesus said to his disciples, I will send the spirit, and when the spirit comes, he will testify of me. I will tell him what to say and deliver unto you. So the spirit of God cannot tell you that your sins will stand. If the spirit tells you that your sins will stand before God, is disqualifying the work of Christ. However, the Spirit will remind you. You know that when Jesus on the cross, all your sin was placed on him. The Spirit came to glorify the name of Jesus. He will take Jesus the sin. And he will preach Jesus to you. How Jesus became sin. How Jesus was nailed because of you. Everything about Jesus, he will tell you about how all your mess was placed on the Son of God. And that he teach you like that, he will convince you about that sin that you have committed and that Jesus carried. So from here, you acknowledge that yes, it was my sin that nailed him on the cross. In this area, you have been reproved of sin. In this area, you take responsibility that yes, the Son of God who came, it was because of my mess. That's why he comes down. In this area, you have been reproved of sin. Then quickly he takes your mind back to righteousness. And tell you, Jesus, who resurrected, is now your righteousness. Do you understand? He tells you, Jesus is your righteousness. He died to put an end to your sin. And he resurrected as your righteousness to be received. Now, the reason why John said, in 1 John 1, that he said, if we say we have not sinned, we make God a liar, and the truth is not in us. This is not talking about the church. This is not even talking about people who don't hear the gospel yet. This is talking about religious people who are rejecting Christ. So imagine I preach Jesus to you, and I tell you that this man Jesus has died for you. He died for you. And you said, how dare you? I don't have any sin. I don't believe in sin. I don't believe anything but sin. That is Jesus, I don't know him. You make him a liar. Why? Because the Bible says, he sent his son to come and die for you. And yet you are saying, you has nothing to do with sin. So in John chapter 8, you can see that Jesus and the Pharisees had a strong argument. They said, we are the seed of Abraham. They said, we are the seed of Abraham. We are not of the slave woman. Therefore, we have nothing to do with sin. Therefore, we have nothing to do with sin. So in this case, they devalue Christ. Because Jesus came because of sin. And when you say, no, I don't believe in this, your sin issue. You make Jesus useless. Why? Because he came here because of man's sin. So John 1 is really referring. It's referring to atheists. It's referring to people who say they have nothing to do with sin. We don't believe in God. We don't believe in anything called God. We don't believe in anything. So in this case, John said, if you say you have no sin, if you check the word there, if you check the word, it is in past. Because the Bible says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And if you say you have nothing to do with sin, you make God to be a liar. Why? Because he said he sent his son to come and die for you. And he said, you don't have anything to do with sin. So you make him to be a liar. And John chapter 2, people still don't understand. And John write back to them. And as John said, I'm not talking about you, that you don't know the truth. But you know the truth. And the light is in you. And John explained himself. And John said, who then is the liar? He said, a liar is someone who denies the Christ and the Father. Such is an antichrist. An antichrist is someone who denies the existence of Christ. Someone who denies that Jesus died. This has nothing to do with you. This has nothing to do with you. This has nothing to do with you. So you all sin. You all dead. Everything you can think of, God, through Jesus, has already forgiven you.
Amen.
Your sicknesses, your diseases, was all nailed on the cross. God, through Christ, has nailed them on the cross. You don't need to carry sicknesses. You don't need to carry diseases. You don't need to carry any sickness. Because your body is the temple of God. So sickness has to flee from the body. Because the body has God. How can God, the light and darkness, live in the same body? How can the Holy Ghost and God live in the same body? Lives in the same body. So the Bible says, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. You cannot flee someone you don't know you have power over. The devil, the reason why you are fleeing away from the devil, it's because you know the truth. The devil must flee from you. Not you fleeing from me. So you don't need to go to church and be praying against the devil. Someone needs 1 minute to just rebuke. You are spending the whole night to rebuke a defeated Satan. To rebuke someone God, Jesus Christ, by death, has defeated. Read Colossians. Colossians 2, 13 to 15. It tells you how Jesus defeated Satan. And the Bible commanded you that resist him. The Bible, the epistle never tell anybody to pray against Satan. He said, rebuke. That's why you are running authority. When you are driving and you see a policeman, the policeman is already in authority. The moment he said that, he should stop. Why? He's in authority. He has been called with authority. So anything he said, you listen to him. You just obey. The policeman doesn't have to follow you. Hey, stop, stop, stop. The one will make you stop. If you don't stop, you are in trouble. That's exactly who you are. But all your entire life is about how to pray that you will not die. It is about how to pray that you will not die. All your entire life is about praying against the sin, the witches that are against your business. All your entire life is about praying about demons that are destroying your marriage. No. That's a limited life. You rebuke your fallacies. You rebuke your fallacies. He says, submit unto God. Submit unto God. In another word, walk in the spirit. Then resist that devil. All that demons. And you will flee. The reason why demons keep on appearing in your dreams. The reason why you keep on dreaming bad dreams. The reason why you keep on dreaming demons chasing you and they want to kill you. It's because you are full of demon conscious. All your mind and your heart is about demon. And that's why all your dreams are about someone is chasing you and killing you. Because that is in your mind. The reason why I say you eat with unclean hand and you fall sick. It's because you believe in school philosophy. It's because you believe in school philosophy. And that is the difference between you and the village boy. The village boy will eat the same food with unclean hand. And they are always healthy. They are strong. They don't even know who the devil is. They don't even know what food is not clean. They just block the mango, just like that. They just eat. You block it. You wash it. You put it inside your fridge. You do whatever you do. You eat it. And yet you are still in problem. Why? You missed it. What is inside your mind is what manifests through you. You cannot live beyond your own belief. The limiting of your life is right here. How you process here is how it's going to control your entire